Moving on to our next series of presentations, the title is Upside Down and Inside Out, and this is covering ways in which sports are finding audiences in non-traditional markets and venues. So we have three presenters, first of which is Lori Cavan, General Manager, Parks, Recreation, and Culture, the City of Surrey, British Columbia, in Canada. And Lori, are you here? Up. Oh, okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you. So I'm so excited to be here, and I just found it interesting with all the previous presentations. I can just see so many intersections as we work through the various topics that are being presented. So as my introduction indicated, really trying to show different ways that we are finding new audiences and using venues in different ways. So. And I'm also going to share with you a little bit about the city of Surrey so you can just get some context to the community that I'm speaking to. So some creative thinking, hopefully. You'll find that in my subject matter here. So the city of Surrey, we have a population of just over 500,000 people. We're nestled on the west coast of Canada. So within a 40-kilometer radius, we have an adjacent population of about 2.7 million people. And we're one of the fastest growing communities in Canada. So just a little visual there to put our community in context. We're located strategically between two international airports. As I said, along the west coast of Canada, we're right adjacent to the U.S. border, and we have a very tempered climate, so not what many people think of Canada, but we can really host many outdoor sports year-round in our climate. So we are a diverse city, and what's making us diverse is we're really going through a transition from a suburban community to an urban community. And this driving growth has really presented a number of opportunities for us. A lot of that is happening through immigration, so we're seeing over 100 languages spoken within our community. And this rapid growth has also presented an opportunity for us to really invest in sport infrastructure. So over the past 5 years, we've seen $150 million come into infrastructure, primarily in the development of two FINA 50-meter pools. And on the horizon, we continue to have investments in sport infrastructure. And hopefully, as I share my story, you'll get an understanding of how we've been able to secure those resources and get support for that investment. So we have a sport tourism strategy that's called Ahead of the Game, and it was adopted basically around the 2010 Olympics that were hosted in the west coast of Canada, and that really got the attention of our mayor and council, where they saw there was a tremendous opportunity for us to develop a sport hosting strategy for our community as an edge city. So we weren't the main host of those Olympics, but it really opened their eyes to what we could do as a community. So as we developed that strategy, we built strong partners within our local business community, with our tourism association, with our community organizations, and our NGOs. And I think that's part of what we've been hearing, just how important those strength of relationships are in your local community to become a strong host. So we are talking about how we can use venues in different ways. So one traditional event we had in our community was a Cloverdale Rodeo. So it's the second largest rodeo in Canada, and it was very, very successful. But we started to look at it and said, you know, there's maybe some revitalization we can do to that event, and there's some different ways that we can use the grounds on which we've been hosting the rodeo. So we looked at trying to bring in events with event holders that could activate that space. The grounds themselves were not creating that dynamic experience, but by bringing in unique events where they could build obstacle courses, those who wanted to participate on a recreational level in a sport event could have a fun and exciting experience. So we worked to sort of change that up and bring in dynamic events. In the traditional rodeo, we were able to partner to bring in freestyle skateboarding event, and that, again, broadened our audience, change the dynamic of the event a bit. And we were able to do that within some facilities on the grounds that weren't being utilized. This particular event we were able to host inside a curling facility when the ice was out during the rodeo season. So it didn't need a lot of capital investment, but created a new audience and a different type of sport venue happening. Again, the whole different experience coming in with events such as Color Me Rad, so participation events, getting our community active and engaged in participating and bringing in visitors from outside of our community as well. So I was just going to touch on BMX, and the reason why I chose this sport when we're looking at developing new facilities, we were able to build this facility adjacent to a major sporting athletic facility on some vacant land that wasn't being utilized, that was parkland. So we were able to go in, build this facility, and we were able to do that with really engaging the local community and the BMX community and develop an international level facility, and that also enabled us to host international level events. So the whole continuum of participation from training, young athlete development, to competition. Cyclocross is another event we were able to bring in. It didn't need a designated facility. We were able to utilize our park system to advance that type of sport hosting opportunity. So again, with regional Western level events and at a lower cost, bring that into our community. We're currently looking at exploring other sport hosting opportunities that are a little bit more non-traditional and that we're able to host within our existing facilities and really do not need sport-specific facilities built. So things like drone racing and esports. So we have a significant number of sports fields and lots of success in hosting traditional outdoor sports, soccer, baseball, softball. But we really wanted to look at diversifying what we were hosting on our sports fields. So we've been moving into areas such as Ultimate Frisbee, which is played in over 75 countries across the world, and Quidditch. So I'm not sure how many people are familiar with that sport. If any of you read Harry Potter, you might be familiar with that sport, but it's a younger demographic playing it and a new sport that we've been able to bring into our community. Kabaddi is a sport played in a couple of cities in Canada. Again, it's a sport that we were able to embrace a new audience, partnering with our strong South Asian community that reside in the city of Surrey. So it's like a sport wrestling event, and the development of the facility is fairly limited. It can happen in any open sports field area, and just you need to bring in the spectator opportunity around that event. But a new sport that we've been partnering with our community and bringing in professional athletes that are on a particular circuit moving across the world. Another new sport that we've been exploring, and it's just been exploding in Canada and North America, and it's called pickleball. It's been played both locally, and we're now hosting provincial level events, and we really see this sport growing in the future. So we started off with modifying some of our existing infrastructure, and it's now so popular that we're building purpose-built pickleball facilities. And this particular facility, in terms of where we building things in unique locations, is on top of a water reservoir. So again, a space that couldn't be used for other purposes, but we've been able to develop some sport-specific opportunities on that venue. Another sport very popular in many parts of the world, in North America, it's just sort of in its infancy, I would say. But with the immigration dynamics within our community, there's been a lot of demand for cricket. So in terms of progressing that sport in our community, we were initially providing cricket facilities with an overlay of a cricket pitch on two soccer fields with the wicket down the middle of the two soccer fields. And that way we've been able to provide opportunities to develop that sport. We've now been able to build sport-specific cricket facilities and hope in the future to be able to host events related to cricket in our community. So we've heard a lot about the importance of partnership, and it's something that we've been really focusing on. Again, I think it's been a way for us to add to our sport hosting opportunities. So partnering with professional sport organizations that are not residing within our community. We don't have a large spectator facility, but in the absence of that, how can we build those strong partnerships? So a couple of examples here, one being a relationship we have with the Whitecaps FC, and they themselves put on an event for U16 and U18 players where they come to our community, run that event with a few hundred teams, and invite coaches and scouts from universities and colleges across Canada and the U.S. to come to our community. So showing that strong partnership with a professional sport organization really helps to develop sport within our community and their fan base as well. So a few other examples there, but I know it's been a long afternoon for everyone. We see that women in sport is definitely an area that we're committed to, both with the core values of our city and our community, but definitely an opportunity for us to expand within that market. And I'm really excited that just in the last few weeks, we have been able to confirm an agreement with Haley Wickenheiser to host city for WICFest, which is an expansion of a hockey event, women's hockey event, that she has previously hosted and will continue to host in Calgary, but expand into the city of Surrey. We're known for hosting a number of women's softball events. So we started with the Canada Cup, which is an international softball event, and we've had that for a number of years. But based on the success of that event, the benefits and economic benefits of that event within our city, we were able to secure a strong partnership to move ahead and host in 2016 the Women's World Softball Championships within the city of Surrey. So moving from 9 international countries coming to our community to 30. So again, building on that progression of experience, volunteers and skills, and community commitment to events. So I've mentioned that we've been investing in infrastructure in our community, and I truly believe we've been able to do that by the way we've structured our sport hosting strategy, where we've said we'll really build our facilities first for our local community, and then we'll enhance those facilities so that they can host world-class events. And that's really gained traction within the community and a commitment from our political individuals that are making those decisions to invest in that infrastructure. We are committed to developing accessible sport opportunities, so building our facilities above and beyond the building code, and then reaching out and fostering strong partnerships with our local sport organizations, such as Sportability, so that we can host more sports and events for individuals with disabilities. And of course, we've heard how important it is to share the cultural richness of your community when you're hosting events. So instead of trying to separate the two, really we bring them together so athletes, fans, and audiences have an opportunity to experience some of the rich cultural festivals that our community puts on, such as the Fusion Festival. So I have a quick video to share with you today. I know I've run through that quickly, but well, I'll let the video play and then I'll close. Scenery,
ocean shorelines and urban centers, along with a birds and culinary scene, unique venues and attractions, affordable accommodations, and a diverse welcoming culture. Creating a hosting experience like no other, Sport Surrey goes above and beyond to welcome world-class sporting events to our state-of-the-art facilities, which host everything from races and rodeos to kabaddi, cricket, soccer, track, rugby, and softball. Let our knowledgeable, experienced sport hosting staff help you with every detail, including bid preparation, funding applications and grants, venue and transportation booking, accommodations, accessibility requirements and volunteer recruitment, event promotion and connections to local partnerships. Come and experience what our city has to offer. Bring your sporting event to Surrey and we'll help you get ahead of the game. For more information, visit sportsurrey.com.
So in closing, I just want to say that I think by developing a strong sport hosting strategy, we've really been able to advance the opportunities within our community and position us for the future. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Lori. Our next presenter from the City of Rotterdam is Erminike van Baxmeer, Director of Sports and Culture for the Municipality of Rotterdam.
Thank you, and well, I'm at least am inspired by all those beautiful stories we heard, and I hope you have some energy left for mine. I want to talk to you about the Dutch approach to organizing sport events. Last September, the City of Rotterdam hosted the grand final World Series Triathlon in the middle of our city, and we had quite a job to make that happen. And we did that together with the ITU and Rotterdam Topsport. Swimming was in the River Maas, and the water, of course, had to be of good quality, which was uncertain until the last days, but we managed. Cycling was planned within our busy city, and we had some challenging curves there. We even had to make temporary bridges, and one of them we named him after our head of security, who came up with the idea to make this bridge, to make it happen. We also had people living in the neighborhood, and they were not always happy because roads were blocked in their neighborhood again. And we came with something up because we invited them months before the whole neighborhood for the World Championships short track, and that worked very well. After the last medal ceremony, I was tired but filled with joy. It had been an amazing weekend with Paralympics and regular athletes in one event. And in the metro on my way home, I sat down next to a man from Kenya in Africa who volunteered during the whole event. He lives in the Netherlands with his wife and kids for a year or two, and he worked at an international organization. And he is a volunteer regularly at sports, and I asked him why. And he said he wants to get to know people and their habits. Sports helps him with that. He also wanted to give something back to the country where he lives in. And he wanted to show his children that this is what you do. And he enjoys sport events in the Netherlands because they are well organized, take good care of volunteers, and children are involved in activities. He said such an event would probably never or easily take place in Africa. This he told me last September. In Pyeongchang, the IOC decided that the Youth Olympic Games 2022 will take place on the African continent. And as some of you might know, Rotterdam was preparing a bid for these games. Well, we wish Africa, whatever country may be chosen, a fantastic Youth Olympic Games. And with our experience in using facilities for purposes other than they are built for, like the triathlon, we hope we will inspire Africa, and you here, of course, today. I'm here also on behalf of five sport cities, Amsterdam, Rotterdam, The Hague, Utrecht, Eindhoven. We cooperate in the organization of sport events in the Netherlands. Together with the provinces of Gelderland and Brabant and our National Olympic Committee, work together to make the Holland brand there very well. Let me show you how we work together at the Dutch approach. And we use for that the beautiful orange tulp. We even have them here. If you like it, you can come to our booth 51 and you might get one. The Dutch approach we have in organizing events, it starts with a firm base. This base is formed by working closely together as cities and provinces. First of all, we inform each other on our ambitions and plans, so when we travel to an international conference like this, we know how to support each other in hosting the best suitable events. And we have all, as cities, different propositions. This is why you don't find any Amsterdam, Rotterdam or Dutch City booth, but our booth at 51. What we do, we develop and share knowledge as cities and information on a regular basis. As an example, I can show you the webpage of a tool we call the Model Aanpak, and it's a format for event organizers in the Netherlands that prevents them of inventing things over and over again. So after every event, we ask organizers to be open about their successes and failures. And it makes us learn from each event and become it to make it better every time. But what we also do is organize events together. For example, the World Championship Beach Volleyball were a huge success in 2015. And one of the reasons was that we organized the matches on center court everywhere. We built four temporary stadiums in four cities on existing places. And the players and staff, they were thrilled, and so was the audience. In The Hague, we had a stadium floating in a reservoir next to our House of Parliament. And in Amsterdam, we built a temporary venue at the famous Dam Square, right in front of the Royal Palace in the city center. And in Rotterdam, it was in front of a former steamship. So this is the fundament of our tulip, working together. But what we also like to do is to make it innovative. For us, an event isn't restricted, for example, to the period it takes place. We stretch it as long as we can at the before and after. So we try really to have a long-term legacy with the facilities, the audiences, and the celebrations. With the facilities, we try to really set a new standard when deciding where to organize it. So we do it in existing locations. Laurie, I thought you did a very good job in Canada, but we try to do it in the Netherlands too. The temporary venues, we use the city really as a stage. So when you look at your city, you see it as a stage, you see all kind of opportunities to make it like that. For example, here, the basketball 3x3 is in Amsterdam. It's underneath a railway station. It fits very well with the urban character of the sport. And part of the European Champion Athletic in 2016 also took place outside the Olympic Stadium of Amsterdam, organized in the city center too, in front of the Royal Palace. But what we also do is change stadiums for the purpose they were. For example, here, The Hague organized the European Championship field hockey in a stadium originally built for soccer. And these fields now are used by the hockey clubs around The Hague, and they were very proud now that they use these fields. So that's a legacy too. This is Amsterdam again, the European Championships Athletics in 2016, and the speed skating, and it was all built in the Olympic Stadium, built in 1928. And in months before the event, also last winter, a lot of people came there to be able to skate there themselves on the coolest ice skating rink. Well, it was very cool to be there. This is Rotterdam, this is Ahoy. It's our well-known concert and congress center, and it's like a chameleon, and it can be turned into any sports facility we want, from volleyball here to the BMX. And this is the same venue with the tennis, and in the same month we turned it to a short track stadium. So every time we rebuild this sport palace. And next to it, we just opened last month a 50-meter swimming pool. And this one is built, not new. So we didn't offer any public space, but we built this swimming pool 50 meters, and there's also 25 meters, in a former office of the city of Rotterdam. And at the opening, we make it a record-breaking place. So there were about 400 children doing bommetje at the same time. I don't know if you know it, you know, just get into the water at the same time. The vice mayor got very wet with that, so it was very nice. The last thing I want to tell you about our facilities is that we strive to never build white elephants. An example here is our new rowing facility in Rotterdam. As you might know, the Netherlands is underneath sea level, and this part here is one of the lowest parts of the Netherlands, and we built a rowing track. because we also use it as a water basin. So when there's a lot of rain or the rivers might overflow, we can use this area to get the water to it. And it's at the same time a FINA Olympic-proof facility. In 2016, we hosted here the World Rowing Championship for non-Olympic numbers. And in 2019, it will be home to the World Rowing Cup. We also try to be innovative in reaching audiences and the way we try to get them interested in sport with side events. We want people really to attend to the event and take part of it themselves. And long before here, the yellow jersey first rode through the streets of Rotterdam and Utrecht, hundreds of children took part in cycling lessons and competitions in the streets of the Dutch cities. What we do as the cities together is minimum 3 events per year to organize them in close collaboration with all the sports clubs in the Netherlands. And also here, this is the beach volleyball match was played. Hundreds of children learned about volleyball and played in the sands. And also with the triathlon, we organized school triathlons a month before it. We also try to change society and improve people's lives. This is the yearly equestrian event in Rotterdam, the Concours Hippique International Officiel. But it's also an engine for wonderful projects that started as a side event. For example, when in contact with horses, we see behavioral change with children who suffer from autism or traumatic background. And the project here is able to grow because of the attention that the upcoming European Championship in 2019 is generated here. This is our Queen Maxima. You might not know her in this picture because she's always wearing beautiful dresses, etc., but she's also a very good swimmer. And we use her popularity to the Amsterdam, the city swim there, and to raise money to cure ALS diseases. So there she was swimming in the Amsterdam canal. And Henk, he's over here. Henk, you've been swimming there too, did you? Yes, he did. This is a stunning picture too of Amsterdam with the BMX in the Urban Sports Week we did at. But a photo like this won't easily be taken again in Amsterdam or Rotterdam because our two cities decided to ban all marketing for unhealthy products focuses on children during these kind of events. We prefer to help them make healthy choices and ask event organizers not to display the names and products of these kind of sponsors. Henk will tell some more about it tomorrow. The celebrations, this is the final part, is the way we try to organize it innovatively. We try to do it too. We want to be them for everyone, and not just for the VIPs, you know, or the people like us, but for everyone. So young and old, whether you're a sports fan or not, from all groups in society. We even talked about the marathon last weekend in Rotterdam, that the whole track, the people were there cheering up because they felt this was also a very nice event for them. And we know that they are bigger when our own at least perform outstanding and win medals. This is our own ladies' soccer team last summer. They won the European Championship women's soccer. We didn't expect that to be, but they did, so we were very proud of that. What we also do is that we build special medal plazas, like this one in Amsterdam, and we want openings to be free and open for everyone to be involved in that. Last thing, this is in front of our iconic Rotterdam Central Station. You see, we people like to dress in orange. I saw just earlier today someone who had this orange hair within our group. Well, he's not, I believe, from the Dutch delegation, but well, we try to dress in orange. And what we do is accommodate fan zones in all cities when we have events. So not just in the city where the event is taking place, but also in other events. And here we walked from this event place all to the stadium, through the whole city, to the Sparta Stadium to visit the football match. And that worked for everyone. Roads were filled and it was great fun. So this is what we try to do, to have innovation in facilities, in audiences and in celebrations. and it's built upon working together as Dutch cities and work on a legacy. And because of that, after, for example, the beach volleyball, we have now more facilities in this sport in our neighborhoods, because we turned over some old sport courts into beach volleyball facilities. We have now 30-plus female soccer players after the soccer tournament. And we are able to make more inhabitants of the Netherlands and our visitors to visit our big and great events. Well, thank you for your attention and hope to see you in the Netherlands.
Certainly ideas in that presentation that I think many of our cities in this room can benefit from. For our final presentation on non-traditional markets and locations is Mr. S.R. Gabriel, GAFE Senior Advisor for Multisport Games.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to present here to cities and looking at the energy and the vibe coming up from projects already achieved. I'm sure you'll be interested in this. This is a teaser of a world premiere that the General Association of International Sports Federation is going to be launching very soon. As you might know, the leadership of GIFES has initiated a number of transformations of the organization a couple of years ago, and one outstanding dossier was what to do with the management of the multi-sports games that SportAccord, now named GIFES, had in its portfolio. You had the mind games, the combat games, and you had also projects like the beach games and the urban games. There was a reboot, and I had the pleasure, although I'm from the Olympic side of sports, I had the pleasure to have a look and review and conduct a strategic review of the portfolio of GIFES. And in January, out of the recommendations that were provided and set forth to the council, one of them, and I would like to focus on that, one of them was code name, this is a working title, the World Urban Games, and revisiting that concept, re-giving it a trajectory, and look to fast-track its implementation. We will be having dedicated sessions tomorrow and after tomorrow. Thanks for those who have already registered. You have received, most of you, I believe, an email inviting you to register, and you will be presented with much more content than what we're looking at today. Urban means learning from the street, and it also means learning from others. And we're very humble in our approach. Out there, there are initiatives, you've seen a couple of them, which are being successful. In particular, and with involvement of international federations, we've been studying a particular event called FISE, the Festival International des Sports Extrêmes. And 2 weeks ago in Hiroshima, there was, after Jeddah in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia kicked off the season, there was the first leg of the FISE event. Some of you are probably familiar with it. There was a little addition there because we're a bit using it as a test event, and I'm putting on my hat as an advisor of Tokyo 2020. In Tokyo in 2020, the Olympic experience will discover what a number of urban sports are about. So the idea was to introduce before, and the president of the International Federation of Gymnastics, Mori Watanabe, should be congratulated for that. So he wanted to introduce in the country what you're going to see in a moment, so that when it hits Tokyo, well, people know what this is about. Let's see what we're looking to emulate. In Hiroshima, in addition to what they have traditionally as their sports, FISE added sports climbing, breakdance, and they added parkour, which is, as you know, being integrated with the International Gymnastics Federation that Watanabe-san is also the president of. Let's look at what it was about. video.
Ryan, it's an honor to be here, not only with you, not only with the best riders in the world, but with all the fans in Hiroshima. This is such a powerful, iconic city, and to have this Asian gem welcoming us with open arms, the excitement is building.
Hiroshima, Japan, welcome to the first stop of the 2018 Baseball Series! Hiroshima,
definitely shake things up, and that is a good thing because BMX welcomed into the Olympics, so we actually in 2020 will be back in Japan in Tokyo.
I think the level in Japan is really high and the young kids killing it. What's gonna be in the Olympic 2020?
Thank you so much to the Japanese fans. We'll see you in France, Montpellier.
That's the trick, huh? So the idea is to precisely take this flavor, and again, my past is general secretary for IAAF, coming from a long history there in Olympic history, working at the IOC, was the boss of the Youth Olympic Games when they were launched. And the idea is to do and serve this community, capture what they are about, and look to take the urban sports to the highest level. And that's the creation of those World Urban Games, what they are about. The concept that we're working on is, in a nutshell, it's the ultimate festival of urban sport in the heart of your city. What we mean by that is that we're looking to be able to showcase the city at its heart what urban sports are about. Being in the city center does come with a sense of focus, meaning we should not be hindering traffic. The idea is to be, in this case, have a footprint which does not come and impede too much or not at all on traffic. We want to be in the spirit of this new generation of sports and athletes and inspire youth. And for that, we are looking to have, on the one side, the best athletes in the sport, because we are guys, but at the same time, come up with a festive atmosphere which brings both together. The mixture we're going for, and this is the concept we are about, and tomorrow and after tomorrow, we'll be laying out more details of the sports, of what the content in a more precise manner is about, and what are the requirements and the benefits of hosting what is going to be the inaugural World Urban Games. And again, that's a working title. On the one side, we're saying pursuit of perfection. That means having the top athletes. Prize money will apply. And we'll look to respecting every single community of urban sport to get their best athletes excited and wanting to be part of this. Creativity comes with what you sow. BMX is going to be, with skateboard, really a breakthrough for Olympic viewership in Tokyo. Believe me, the images you saw there are extremely powerful, and this cuts the angle into how creative those sports are and how much we should embrace them as a community of multi-sports events. Engaging audiences, the city spoke about it. What you see, and my personal experience is, I come from sports where you're maximizing the spectator experience by putting everybody around a field of play. Whereas on those events, the idea is you do have the ability to seat spectators, but the experience is you flow from one field of play to another. And you can see this open space. And that is probably a challenge in Tokyo, where we're trying to get the right mix. We won't get that atmosphere, but we'll tend to it. So that is what we mean by engaging audiences. And of course, the long tail that was presented by previous cities as an example, what you do before, what you do after, and how you engage with the community at large. Involving various sports, GIFE's core mission is to help sports on their trajectory grow, whether they're entering GIFE's as a community or whether they achieve the ultimate goal of wanting to be at the Olympics. That is why we will be showcasing sports which are not known but which are urban, either because they came out of the streets, they're legitimate, or because an international federation has said, I have a plan to develop an urban discipline and I want to do that. So again, the sense of focus. We're not going to get everybody in. It has to be an urban games. Involving numerous sports comes with respecting competitors and also followers. My personal experience going through this journey of developing this concept is that the followers and the competitors, they're really here to engage and be part of a community and then to give their best for their sport. And then that's where they arrive to a land which has been mine, which is competition at its highest level and going for gold, etc. But interestingly, with those communities, that comes, I would say, next, or at least is equal to what I just spoke about. Global connectivity. The festival will be about digital entertainment. We saw the drones. We saw other technologies out there. We would like to keep out thermic motors, but electrical linked sports could fly or could drive or could X, Y, and Z. But we're trying to keep focused on a concept for those world urban games. Lifestyle, obviously, it goes without saying for this type of community. And finally, the environment, which is important. I spoke about the efforts and the idea and for this concept not to impede, for example, on traffic. This is in a nutshell what the concept and the creator to give birth to the World Urban Games is about by GIFE's. And we look forward to giving precise presentation on what this is about, if you are interested, requirements, benefits, the energy of it. And we would invite you to register if you have not, to see the presentations. There's two sessions, two slots tomorrow and after tomorrow. The way forward is that the GIFE's, its leaders, are meeting in a council Thursday, and they will have a final go at what this is about. And hopefully, you will be hearing more about how this is going to be implemented in a very short time frame. So we would invite you to and welcome you to those sessions, and we would really, really look forward to engage with you. What we hope we'll be creating is a period of dialogue, and then we would fold into looking to lock in with one host city on a very short term, and that is ahead of us. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.